Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In our last class, we discussed about the potential field due to a point charge and a system of charges. And then we introduced a new terminology, that is the potential gradient. Today we will use that terminology in order to determine the potential field and the electric field intensity at a point due to a dipole. What is actually a dipole? An electric dipole assembly, a dipole is the name given to two point charges of equal magnitude and opposite sign, separated by a distance which is small compared to the distance to the point P at which we want to know the electric and potential fields. We have two point charges separated by a small distance d, and these two point charges actually represent a dipole. We have to find the electric and potential fields at point P due to this dipole, and remember that this distance d is very small compared to r, where r is the distance of point P from the center of the dipole. So we will determine the electric and potential fields at point P due to this dipole. Remember that the coordinates for plus Q are 0, 0, d by 2, whereas the coordinate for minus Q is 0, 0, minus d by 2, because this dipole is along the z-axis, and along the z-axis the x and y components are, the x and y coordinates are 0. So the distance between these two point charges is d, so this distance will be d by 2 and this distance will be d by 2. So the coordinates for plus q will be 0, 0, d by 2, whereas the coordinates for minus q will be equal to 0, 0, minus d by 2. Similarly, if we take the spherical coordinates for the point P, so the point P coordinates will be equal to r, theta and phi. The coordinates for point P will be equal to r, theta and phi, and if we take phi as 90 degrees, so this point P will be in the yz plane or in the x is equal to 0 plane. If we take phi as 90 degrees, so this point P will be in the yz plane or x is equal to 0 plane. The distant point P is described by the spherical coordinates r, theta and phi, and if we consider phi is equal to 90 degrees, so this point P will be in the yz plane or x is equal to 0 plane in view of the azimuthal symmetry. The positive and negative point charges have separation d and Cartesian coordinates 0, 0, d by 2 and 0, 0, minus d by 2 respectively, as we already discussed. So much for the geometry. What would we do next? Should we find the total electric field intensity by adding the known components of each point charge? Or would it be easier to find the total potential field first? In either case, having found one, we shall find the other from it before calling the problem solved. What does it mean? Our main goal is to find the electric and potential fields at point P. Now there are two methods. We can find the electric field intensity at point P due to plus Q and due to minus Q. And then we can determine the total electric field intensity by adding the two results. We can find the potential from the electric field intensity by taking the line integral. This was actually one method, that if we पे टोटल इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड इंटेंसिटी फाइंड आउट कर लें और फिर इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड इंटेंसिटी से हम पोटेंशियल फाइंड आउट कर लें. बट रिमेंबर दैट द लाइन इंटीग्रल ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड इंटेंसिटी एक्चुअली गिव्स अस द पोटेंशियल डिफरेंस बिटवीन टू पॉइंट्स. सो इन ऑर्डर टू डिफाइन आर इन ऑर्डर टू फाइंड द पोटेंशियल वी हैव टू डिफाइन अ सूटेबल जीरो रेफरेंस. Now, what is the second method? The second method is to find the electric potential at point P due to plus Q and due to minus Q. And by taking the negative gradient of electric potential, we can determine the electric field intensity. So, we have two methods. Ke pehle hum electric field intensity find out kar le aur usse phir potential find out kar le. Lekin jab hum electric field intensity se potential find out karte hain, to uske liye hume ek specific जीरो रेफरेंस की जरूरत है. एंड व्हाट इज द सेकंड मेथड कि हम पॉइंट पी पे पहले पोटेंशियल फाइंड आउट कर ले ड्यू टू प्लस क्यू एंड माइनस क्यू और फिर उसका नेगेटिव ग्रेडियंट लेके हम इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड इंटेंसिटी फाइंड आउट कर ले. सो इफ वी चूज टू फाइंड द इलेक्ट्रिक फील्ड इंटेंसिटी फर्स्ट वी शैल हैव टू कंपोनेंट्स टू कीप ट्रैक ऑफ इन स्फेरिकल कोऑर्डिनेट्स. It means that the EZ component is zero, or we can say that the Z components of the electric field intensity cancel out each other. Similarly, symmetry shows that E phi component is also zero because we have two point charges and those point charges are along the Z axis. There is no other point charge to produce the phi component of the electric field intensity. And then the only way to find the electric potential from the electric field intensity is by the use of the line integral. The last step includes establishing a zero reference for potential, since the line integral gives us only the potential difference between the two points at the ends of the integral path. We already discussed this point. कि अगर हम electric field intensity पहले find out करते हैं, उससे हम potential find out करते हैं, तो line integral असल में हमें पोटेंशियल डिफरेंस देता है बिटवीन द टू पॉइंट्स अलोंग द इंटीग्रल पाथ. तो हम क्या करते हैं कि पहले पोटेंशियल फाइंड आउट करते हैं ड्यू टू प्लस क्यू एंड ड्यू टू माइनस क्यू एंड देन वी एड द रिजल्ट्स. सो वी इज इक्वल टू क्यू डिवाइड बाय 4 पाई एप्सिलॉन नॉट आर वन माइनस क्यू डिवाइड बाय 4 पाई एप्सिलॉन नॉट आर टू ड्यू टू प्लस क्यू एंड ड्यू टू माइनस क्यू एट पॉइंट पी. So the total V will be equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught 1 over R1 minus 1 over R2. And by simplifying this equation, the result will be Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R2 minus R1 divided by R1 R2. Now, if we look at this equation, from this equation, we can define the zero reference for potential. How? If R1 is equal to R2. It means that if we take the point along the y-axis, अगर point हम y-axis पे लें, तो along the y-axis R1 will be equal to R2. And when R1 is equal to R2, the potential will be zero because R2 minus R1 will be equal to zero. So note that the plane z is equal to 0 midway between the two points is the locus of points for which r1 is equal to r2 and is therefore at zero potential. As are all points at infinity. Like agar isi point ko hum y axis pe le, so r1 will be equal to r2 aur jab r1 r2 ke equal ho to potential hamare paas zero. So this y-axis is actually the locus of all points at which the potential is equal to zero. So we can consider the y-plane as a plane of zero reference for potential. Now, how to simplify this equation? For a distant point, R1 is approximately equal to R2 and the product R1 R2 in the denominator may be replaced by R square. When R1 is equal to R2, so the product R1, R2 may be replaced by R square. The approximation may not be made in denominator. However, without obtaining the trivial answer that the potential field approaches zero as we go very far away from the potential, from the dipole. Coming back a little closer to dipole, we see from figure that R2 minus R1 may be approximated very easily if R1 and R2 are assumed to be parallel. So R2 minus R1 will be equal to d cos of theta, and the final result is then V is equal to Q d cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. Now what does it mean? I already told you that this distance d is very small as compared to R. So agar ye distance bahut kam hoga as compared to R, so it means that this R1 and R2, this is actually R1 and this is actually R2. So in dono ko hum parallel assume kar sakte hain. Now remember that we don't know about R1, we don't know about R2, we only know about the R and the angle that R is making with z axis, and that is actually the theta. That is actually the theta. So अब हमने क्या करना होगा कि हमने R1 और R2 को in terms of R and theta represent करना होगा. Because we only know about this distance of point P from the center of the dipole. And we only know about the theta. So अब हमने R1 और R2 को in terms of theta और R represent करना है. Now how can we represent R1 and R2 in terms of R and theta? So let's suppose this point is point A, and let's suppose this point is point B, and let's suppose this origin is point C. So this is actually the origin. We have point A, we have point B, and we have point C. If we drop a perpendicular from point A over the R, अगर मैं पॉइंट ए से आर पे एक परपेंडिकुलर ड्रॉप करूं, सो इट मींस दैट लेट्स सपोज दिस पॉइंट इज पॉइंट डी, इट मींस दैट ये एक डिस्टेंस है, ये है. तो मैं क्या करता हूं कि ए से ये आर है, आर पे एक परपेंडिकुलर ड्रॉप करता हूं, एंड लेट्स सपोज दिस पॉइंट इज पॉइंट डी. तो अगर आप इसी फिगर को आप देख लें, सो फ्रॉम दिस फिगर AP is actually equal to DP. अगर हम पॉइंट A से R पे एक परपेंडिकुलर ड्रॉप कर लें, so AP distance AP will be equal to DP. It means that R1 will be equal to DP because AP is equal to R1. Now, if we want to represent R1 in terms of R and theta, अगर मैंने R1 को in terms of R और theta represent करना है, so I have to find the CD first. I have to find the CD first. As we know that the angle which R is making with Z axis is theta, and this distance is actually d by 2. ये जो distance है, ये distance. This is actually the d by 2. And this angle is actually theta. So, the CD will be equal to CD is actually d by 2 cos of theta. I am repeating it again. The distance between plus Q and minus Q is actually D. So, the distance between the origin and plus Q is D by 2, and the distance between the origin and minus Q is equal to D by 2. So, when this distance is actually D by 2, so the CD will be equal to D by 2 cos of theta. Now, we can write that R1 is equals to R minus D by 2 cos of theta, because AP is equals to CP minus CD. AP is equals to CP minus CD, and we know that AP is equal to R1, CP is equal to R, and CD is equal to D by 2 cos of theta. So in this way I represented R1 in terms of R and theta. Now how can we represent R2 in terms of R and theta? So now what should I do? I am dropping a perpendicular from point C over R2. And let's suppose this point is point E. Ab main kya karta hun? K main C se R2 pe ek perpendicular drop karta hun. It means that this is actually R2. To main kya karta hun? K C se R2 pe ek perpendicular drop karta hun. And this point is actually D. So if this is actually theta, this will be theta, and this distance will be equal to, because this distance is D by 2, so this distance will be equal to D by 2 cos of theta. And we already know that this distance EP is equal to R. When EP is equal to R, this is actually point E. EP is equal to R. So R2 will be equal to R plus D by 2 cos of theta, because we know that BP is equal to EP plus BE, because BB is equal to EP plus BE. So R2 will be equal to R plus D by 2 cos of theta. So we found that R1 is equal to R minus D by 2 cos of theta, and R2 is equal to R plus D by 2 cos of theta. So we represented R1 and R2 in terms of R and cos of theta. Now let's come back to the potential at point P due to the dipole. We know that the potential at point P due to a dipole is equal to Q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R2 minus R1 divided by R1 R2. Now, we know that R2 is equal to R plus D by 2 cos of theta, and R1 is equal to r minus, so minus minus plus d by 2 cos of theta. Similarly, in the denominator, r1 is equal to r plus d by 2 cos of theta, and r2 is equal to r1 is equal to r minus d by 2 cos of theta, and r2 is equal to r plus d by 2 cos of theta. So r1, r2 will be equal to r square minus d square divided by 4 cos square theta. A plus b and a minus b. So it will be equal to a square minus b square. Now, if we look at this equation, plus r and minus r cancels out, and I have told you in the start that r is very large as compared to d. It means that d, the distance between plus q and minus q, is very small as compared to r. So if d is very small, if d is very very small as compared to r, so d square will be too much small as compared to r square. So we can neglect this term, because this term is too small, and the result will be equal to q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square, and d by 2 cos of theta plus d by 2 cos of theta. So it will be equal to d cos of theta. So the potential at point P due to the dipole will be equal to q d cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. V is equal to q d cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. And this is actually the final result which we got, that V is equal to q d cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. Now, how can we find the electric field intensity? So by taking the negative gradient of the electric potential, we can find the electric field intensity. And from this equation, we can also prove that y-axis, or the y-plane, is actually a plane of zero potential. How? When theta is equal to zero, the potential becomes maximum. That is, if we measure the potential along the axial line of the dipole, and along the axial line, it means that along the z-axis, theta will be equal to 0. Similarly, if we take the theta as 90 degree, agar theta ko hum 90 degree kar le, it means that along the y-axis, cos of 90 is equal to 0 and v is equal to 0. So along the equatorial line, along the y-axis, the potential is zero. It doesn't mean that the electric field is zero. The electric field is there, but the potential field is zero. So V will be equal to q d cos of 90 degree divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. And cos of 90 degree is equal to zero, so V is equal to zero. So along the y-axis, this potential will be zero. So the y-plane can be considered as a plane of, the y-axis can be considered as a plane of zero reference for potential. So again, we know that the plane z is equal to zero, or theta is equal to 90 degree, is at zero potential. Using the gradient relationship in spherical coordinates, because we have already taken the quantities in spherical coordinate system, so we will take the gradient relationship in spherical coordinates. So in spherical coordinates, E is equal to minus the negative gradient of potential, and the formula is minus partial by partial r of V a r plus 1 over r partial by partial theta of V a theta plus 1 over r sine theta partial by partial phi of V a phi. So as V is a scalar function, so V is qd cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. So, yahan pe qd cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r square. And we have to differentiate it with respect to r. So, the result will be qd cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r cube. सिमिलरली यहां पे v को हमने डिफरेंशिएट करना है विद रिस्पेक्ट टू थीटा, सो cos ऑफ थीटा विल बिकम माइनस साइन ऑफ थीटा, बिकॉज द डिफरेंशिएशन ऑफ cos ऑफ थीटा इज एक्चुअली माइनस साइन थीटा, और यहां पे एक r ऑलरेडी मौजूद है तो दिस विल बिकम r क्यूब. एंड यहां पे हमने विद रिस्पेक्ट टू phi डिफरेंशिएट करना है, एंड विद रिस्पेक्ट टू phi v इज एक्चुअली अ कांस्टेंट बिकॉज देयर इज नो phi इन द पोटेंशियल इन द इक्वेशन ऑफ द पोटेंशियल फील्ड, सो द रिजल्ट will become zero. This term will become zero. So we will get E is equal to QD divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R cube 2 cos of theta AR plus sine theta A theta. So this is actually the electric field intensity at point P due to a dipole. So actually what did we do? We found the potential first. And by taking the negative gradient of the potential, we find the electric field intensity due to the dipole. Now, if we look at the equation of potential, this QD term is actually called the dipole moment because the product of the charge and the distance is actually called the dipole moment, and dipole moment is a vector quantity. So this relation will become V is equal to P cos of theta divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. R D cos of theta can be written as D dot AR. So this relation can be written as P dot AR. Like the potential field of the dipole may be simplified by making use of the dipole moment. Remember that dipole moment is actually a vector quantity and it is equal to the product of charge into the distance. So let us first identify the vector length directed from minus q to plus q as d, and then define the dipole moment as qd and assign it the symbol p. So p will be equal to qd and the units for p are coulomb meter. Since we know that d dot ar is equal to d cos of theta, The component of D in the direction of R is actually D cos of theta, and it is equal to D dot AR. So we then have V is equal to P dot AR divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R square. And this result may be generalized as V is equal to 1 divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R minus R dash whole square P dot AR. R minus R dash divided by R minus R dash ka mod. It means that R is the distance of the point P from the center of the dipole. And R dash represents the location of the dipole center. When R dash is equal to zero, so the dipole will be at the origin. The center of the dipole will be at the origin. Similarly, when R dash has some value, so R dash actually locates the center of the dipole. Now, let's come to the conclusion. If we look at the equation for the potential field due to a dipole, varies as the square of the distance. Similarly, the electric field intensity due to a dipole varies as the cube of the distance. So, graph in those equations ko previous equations ke saath compare kar le, the electric field intensity due to a point charge was varying with the square of the distance. Similarly, if we look at this equation, the electric field intensity varies as the cube of the distance from the dipole. Similarly, if we look at the potential field due to a point charge, so the potential field due to a point charge varies as inversely as the distance, because the potential field due to a point charge is equal to q divided by 4 pi epsilon naught r. Whereas, if we look at the potential field due to a dipole, it varies inversely as the square of the distance. So that is the main difference between the potential field due to a dipole and the potential field due to a point charge. Similarly, the electric field intensity at point P due to a dipole and the electric field intensity at point P due to a point charge. And this was all about the electric and potential fields at point P when we have at a general point when we have a dipole. So these are actually the final results. If you have any question, you can ask. Thank you.